The world of audio processing has changed over the last few decades. What was once an elaborate, time-consuming, and generally expensive discipline of engineering has seen a major shift towards digitization, which has made itself widely available to essentially everybody. Back when there were no computers or digital systems, analog audio signals had to be recorded onto magnetic tapes. Any effects of processing were bulky electronic circuits that modified the signal, and these had to be placed beforehand in the signal chain, and the effects would be irreversible once recorded. And if you had to edit or trim the end result, you'd have to take a pair of scissors and carefully slice the tape reel and reattach it by gluing it to a different section of the tape. And if you wanted to save the audio recording safely for long periods of time, you'd etch the analog footprint of the signal onto a vinyl disc, for example. With the advent of digital systems and the personal computer, engineers devised ways of converting the analog signals into a form that these systems could operate over. This proved incredibly resilient and flexible because it provided control and manipulation capabilities in ways they could have never achieved before. It gave them fine control over every aspect of the signal, right from processing to storage. You could now record several audio signals straight onto your computer, apply effects when needed, store it internally into a hard drive, and then come back to it the next day and just press Control V to undo everything. The digital world was born. But underneath it all, it's just a layer of abstraction for really complicated arrangements of electrical pathways. A good example to quote is the saying that everything in the universe boils down to physics, and everything in physics boils down to mathematics. A biological organism is just a really complicated system of chemical reactions, and chemistry is a really complicated system of nuclear forces in physics. When we talk about signals in the digital domain, we've abstracted away the complexity by introducing new terms like memory or bits and bytes. But underneath the hood, it's just really complicated paths electrical signals can take through diodes and transistors. The digital domain offers a much higher vantage point where you can talk about complicated concepts like inputs and outputs and buffers and memory without needing to understand the underlying complexity. But the digital representation of analog signals, though they sound really convenient, come with a cost and a set of limitations. For better or for worse, we're deeply seated in the digital world today. And understanding the digital domain is key when you're setting up a project to record on your DAW software, or when designing signal processing algorithms for a certain effect, or when just making choices that could either make or break your signal path. So let's start there. The signal path. It's a path a signal takes before reaching its intended target, usually our ears. The simplest signal path is the one that doesn't contain any transformation or processing of the audio signal. We seem to be throwing around the term audio processing and transformation quite a lot here. Audio can exist in one form or another in three broad domains. In the physical world, where we live and breathe, audio exists as physical disturbances of a medium, or more simply, as pressure waves. These pressure waves are the only way for us to experience the auditory sensation of hearing. In the analog and digital domains, audio exists as information via electrical signals. These signals would have to be converted or transformed back into the physical domain for us to hear it. And until then, it's merely just information and nothing else. Conversion would need to happen at each step of transforming a wave from the physical domain to signals in the analog and then to the digital domain. And similar conversions would need to occur in the opposite direction when transforming the signal back into physical waves. Each step of transformation has a cost associated with it, and none of these steps can offer lossless conversion, meaning that the audio quality will be degraded and there will be loss of resolution at each stage. And it's unavoidable. The scale of degradation, however, depends on a lot of factors, which we'll look at later. But we generally want to avoid unnecessary transformation stages. Audio processing, on the other hand, is the modification of audio within the same domain. mainly within either the analog or digital domains. Examples of audio signal processing are amplification, where you boost the strength of a signal, or filtering, where you attenuate or remove certain bands of frequencies from the signal. In a lot of the cases, this processing is lossless and reversible. Let's get back on track with signal paths. I'll present three scenarios where varying levels of transformation is needed. In scenario one, the simplest scenario, a natural source produces sound and we hear it. The sound exists purely in the physical domain and no transformation is applied. Here's a philosophical question for you. Imagine a tree falling to the forest floor deep within a forest, where no human or animal was around within the vicinity to have heard it. The question is, did the falling tree produce any sound if no one was around to hear it? Think about it. Moving on to scenario two, a person is singing into a microphone on a stage, and her voice is being heard to several people through an array of speakers. Here, the vibration of her voice is converted into electrical analog signals through an input transducer, in this case, a microphone. The signal is then fed to a preamplifier, where the signal from the microphone is boosted up and then fed into an output transducer, in this case, a powered speaker, which tries to faithfully convert the analog signal into physical pressure waves by vibrating its cone. So all in all, there are two stages of conversion. Scenario 3. Let's imagine the same vocalist is in a studio trying to record herself. The vocalist sings into a microphone. The microphone is connected to an audio interface, which houses a preamplifier stage, which we saw earlier. But more importantly, it also houses an analog to digital converter, or an ADC, which converts voltage to digital data and is transferred to a computer via a USB cable. When the vocalist wants to listen back to what she sounded like before inevitably requesting another take, the data is transferred back to the audio interface, which is responsible for converting the data back into its analog form using a circuit called the Digital to Analog Converter, or a DAC, and then is transferred to the powered studio monitors for playback. There are four stages of conversion in all. Two stages to get the physical wave into a digital form, and two other stages in the opposite direction. There's a lot we can talk about in the realm of how physical waves are converted into analog signals through transducers, how different microphones work, what determines a frequency response for a microphone, and all that good stuff. But since this module is focused towards audio in the digital domain, we'll stick to exploring just that. Specifically, the analog to digital conversion, the crux of the transformation and all the nuances associated with it. Alright, let's get into it. Let's see what we need to do to transform voltage into data.